Welcome to Sword for the Greek Day here at the Dream in Athens in the Games of the 28th Olympiad. And without further ado, let's cut to the chase and introduce to you the Professor of Dance from Lithgow University. I refer to the man who went six rounds with Dick Pound this morning and emerged victorious after one. Pound powder. No surprises there. Rampaging Roy Slaven. Welcome to Sword for the Greek Day. Story, Roy.
I never tire of it. No. I never tire of the music.
Uh-huh.
You know, where it gets to that. It's great. Isn't it great?
Well, it is.
Sword of the Greek. It was a film, I think, made in 64. Beautiful film.
Yes.
Might have starred Anthony Quinn, who was a very, very close personal friend, and that's a fact.
Yeah, fact.
That's a fact.
How'd you get on with Anthony in the end, Roy?
We were great mates.
Yes.
I liked his style. I liked the cut of his jib. I liked his acting. But, oddly enough, he was not Greek at all.
No.
He was a Mexican.
Is that right?
He was a Mexican. Yeah, yeah.
No surprises there.
No, but he could take on the role of international roles of any type. He was versatile.
And the story, Roy, of Zorba the Greek.
Zorba the Greek.
What's it about?
Oh, I think it's roughly to do with an Englishman played by Alan Bates who goes to Greece mining. Yeah. Employs a bloke called Zorba to help out, you know, settle
digging holes.
Digging holes. They find ruins. They start drinking.
Yeah.
Womanizing.
Yes.
And Alan Bates, the character he plays, has a new lease on life. He discovers the secret to life is more than mining.
Right. Right.
Beautiful film. It still speaks to kids today.
Does it? Yes. What would they be in a safe asylum?
You know, kids, they're born to mine.
Born to mine, right. Listen, it's been another fantastic day of competition here.
Yeah.
And I think, Roy, I need to tap into your Olympic history, because today we have to address how to help a mate in trouble. I'll never forget you in Montreal. There you were with Superfish Stephen Holland in the 1500 metres. You found halfway through, about at the 850 metre mark, a blobbing, you know.
He was drowning.
He was. I think by the time you got to him, he was clinically dead. You pulled him out of the pool while the race was on.
I know.
You gave him mouth to mouth. Look, I know you don't want to talk about it.
I know.
This story has never been told, Roy, because you've always kept it from the press and the public and, you know, Neil Kearney types and Bruce McAvaney types because you're too proud. You're too proud, Roy. You've carried this burden for too long. On Zorba the Great Day, we can take it off your shoulders and put it on the rest of the nation. You pulled Stephen Holland out. You slowed the race up while you gave him mouth to mouth and silver. You got him back into that race. It cost you a medal, Roy.
I know.
It cost you gold.
I know. But that wasn't that important to me. What was more important was supporting a mate. And that's what makes us Australian.
Yes, that's right.
You know, it wasn't the first time the 1500 metres running. You know, I was running along, a mate fell over. He was in trouble. You know, but I knew he wanted to finish more than I did.
So
I went back and lugged the plate, and he wasn't light. He was gone for all money.
He was.
But he wanted to finish, so I lugged him up. We came last. But it didn't matter.
No shame there,
Roy. I was carrying a mate.
You participated.
You know, and I haven't ostracised him or anything.
No.
I phone him every day.
Yeah.
How are you getting on? Do you remember that race? He says, yes, I do. And we lived that. We shared something. We were at the coalface together. We went to war together. Sure, we lost.
But
we won.
Forged a bond.
A friendship. Forged a bond. And that's what the Olympics are all about. And some people forget that. Some people forget that. What the Olympics is all about. It's not about winning.
I know.
It's about humanity.
Very good, Roy.
What makes us human? Good. What separates us from, you know, from animals?
Animals. Oh. Roy, I won't ever forget. You know what? You don't want to talk about this one. I've never talked to you about this one before, but I looked at the vision of it this morning. Moscow 60, team pursuit. You'd swap from the swimming into the cycling because you knew there was trouble in swimming. You're always saving people in swimming. You're on the cycling.
It was corrupt.
Four blokes on a bike. Unfortunately, one failed to start, so you're down to three. Three had to finish. You blew a tyre on lap one. You picked that bloke up on lap two. You had him dinking him around. And then the guy in front who was laying down the grunt for you, he buckled a spoke. He was out of it. He went up in the air. You got your bike underneath him. You stood up and he landed on the seat. You kept going. You brought it home, bro. Three blokes on a bike. Sure, it wasn't a world record time.
We didn't win.
It wasn't the big raps. You didn't get a car from a sponsor or anything out of that.
No sponsorship whatsoever.
But you bought the
team. Called us idiots. They called us idiots at the time.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought we did the right thing. Three blokes on one bike.
Australians to the
Australian,
end.
Australian style.
And so, Roy, we come to this, you know, probe that we've asked for into men's Australian swimming, and, you know, you and I are calling for it, and I know all the teams
I'm
offside.
I'm not resiling.
I know you're not resiling,
I'm not
that's
resiling.
Good. You know, Welch and Clem and all them, they're all offside with us. Commentators in Australia are offside with us, but we're calling for this probe.
That's
we're
right.
going to probe the starts. We're going to probe the finishes.
Probe
we're
the turns.
Probe the turns, and we're going to probe the bits in the middle.
Probe the selections.
Probe the selection process. We're going to probe...
And, you know, John Coates, mm-hmm. John Coates, he phoned me this morning.
Did he, Roy?
He said, call off the probe, one, and he sent me an Olympic tie, as if this is going to make me shut up.
What I'd call petrol onto the bonfire probe is Don Talbot, the senior swimming commentator with the Seven Network, who now claims, apart from the feud simmering, Talbot attacking, and what is his attack? He's saying the blokes are swimming for themselves and not as a team. Roy,
yeah.
You support Don in his call?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes. It's so important to swim as a team.
Uh-huh.
You know, you've got to forget yourself as an... You cease to be an individual once you become Olympian.
Uh-huh.
You become part of an Olympian team.
Yes.
Team.
Team.
That is, you're not swimming for yourself, you're swimming for your colleagues, for your comrades.
Uh-huh.
That's what it's all about. And if Don has sniffed something here, the Don knows, the Don sniffer, when he sniffs... I want to know what he's smelling.
It stinks, doesn't it, Roy? It stinks.
It stinks. Something is rotten in the house called Australian men's swimming.
Yes.
Now, despite what Clem says, despite the tie, despite Coates, despite all the pressure put on you and me, and I know you've had threats.
Well, I have.
I know Clemmy's threatened you.
Death threats.
We're not resiling.
No. And we're not going to the cops either. We're going to take this like
we're
Australians.
We're not dobbers.
No, we're not going to... No, that's right, Clem. Now, Roy... As you know, the women's marathon was held yesterday, and I was tight-lipped and ashen faced at the end of it. Japanese runner Noguchi won.
Did a great job.
Terrific job. And have a look at the finish. She comes into Panathinaiko Stadium here, obviously packed to the, as you'd expect.
At the gunnels.
Yeah, indeed, at an Olympic event.
Yeah.
And have a look at the way she pulls up over the line, grinning like a Cheshire cat as though she could go round again. What disappointed me, Roy, and I know you want to chime in on this, is the original purpose of the marathon was what?
To give the news of the victory against Persia.
Persia fighting Athens in marathon, hence the name of the event. Runner Pheidippides runs all the way.
Yes.
Reveals to the Athenian population that everything you say drops down dead.
That's right.
Now, what do you think the runners should have had yesterday?
Well, the runners, when they got through, it should have been a reenactment. The first runner through climbs a podium.
Yes.
Unveils a scroll.
Uh-huh.
And puts on one of those funny theatrical masks.
Yeah, big
edge. That act as a sort of megaphone.
Ah, oh, yes.
And gives the cry. Hail, fellow citizens of Athens! Beautiful in triumph! Orestes is victor! The war is won!
Ah, fantastic.
Now, yeah. If she doesn't finish getting through that before the next runner comes through, then the next runner has a chance. You see what I mean?
I do. There's a little kick in the end of it.
Yes.
What a lovely idea. What a lovely idea.
And it's not too late to introduce this for the men.
Yes. So every male runner in a marathon would be carrying a scroll in the hip pocket on the off chance that they were the lucky one to, well, you know, the successful one.
Yes, and it should be in the original Greek.
Oh, what a lovely idea. What a lovely idea. Now, this is a cautionary tale for all Olympians and, you know, obviously Olympians watching, future Olympians, about the problem of shoes. It concerns pole vaulter, successful pole vaulter in Sydney, Stacey Dragila. And let's have a look at her going around in the pole vault here in Athens. Tearful Dragila finds an excuse. And here she is on the runway now, bar at 4:40 qualifying height. Let's have a look at what happens to Stacey. She sticks the pole in the hole.
Dog's breakfast.
Dog's breakfast, yes, with vomit. Disappointment all round. Let's have a look at the offending shoe.
Yeah.
There it is there. Up she goes. Can't clear the bar. It's all over on the already at the airport, hailing a plane out of here. Now, Roy, what was the problem with the shoes?
Well, she bought the wrong shoes, HG.
Yes.
They were three sizes too small.
Mm-hmm.
I've got a feeling she might feel as if she has big feet. And honestly, big feet is no... I'm attracted to big feet, as you well know.
Big feet.
Especially in an athlete.
Yes.
But some athletes feel quite self-conscious and so choose smaller shoes so their feet seem smaller, so they seem, to their own minds, more aesthetic. This is what's happened with her, I feel.
Now, she competed in the national titles with a favourite pair of shoes.
Yes.
She bought the new pair afterwards. When did she start having trouble with these smaller...
As soon as she put them on.
Right.
She didn't put them on until the event was about to start. Put them on, wrong size. You know what it's like. Couldn't run, couldn't jump.
Well, what I find amazing is how the brain stopped working as soon as she put the shoes on.
That's it.
Thinking, well, I've got the lucky pair there in the kick. I might as well put them back on.
Preparation, I mean, preparation starts with the feet. Always has done, always will.
There'll be more Dream from Athens right after this. Father there, we've had so many emails wondering what's happened to Keggs Ruzulkov. Well, he isn't here, unfortunately, one of the towering talents of the Sydney Olympics. Sadly, his dad is here and enjoying the heat in his tinny. Just here...
that Keggs Ruzulkov's dad?
It was, yes.
Wow.
Why his dad was in town was he's a hammer freak, as we are. Let's go to the main stadium and take in the final of the Olympic hammer. Yes, well, welcome to the men's hammer throw, the final night, the final round here at the Oaka Stadium. Carsten Cobbs in for his second. He's got the slit in front of him to shove it through. He's in motion. He gets it off the toe there, and it's a beautiful throw. It's way out over the 75 point, I'd say almost 76 metre mark. The coach is not impressed in the stands. Roy Slaven, your thoughts early on in the final round.
Well, this is a dynamic competition. This is the best in the world. It's a great sport. It goes back, HG, to the guilds of Europe, the plumbing guilds, a lefty, and he's grazed it.
Vizzoni from Italy.
A very
grazed
short
it. Throw, 72.97. I'm not sure whether that's perfectly legal, but I suppose, you know, off the lips, good enough.
If you can rim it, that's not a problem. And in the old days, they used to, with frequency, was thought it might help. Yes, toilets were gutted. It was the insides of toilets that were hurled at the Guilds picnics, HG, in the olden days.
What are we talking, 1500s, Roy? 1500s, 1600s?
Beginning of the Guilds, yes.
So we've got...
The Guilds, those Guild picnics. Whoa, they were tremendous.
Murafushi from Japan now.
Praise the gods.
Look at the style of this bloke. He's got it all. He's the complete package. I mean, he's svelte, slim-hipped, and yet he's throwing the hammer. I always thought you had to be a big idiot to throw it, Roy.
No, those days have gone.
That's a beautiful throw. That's off the reservation.
Troubling the Tunstalls enormously.
They had to move their marking idea, you know, how far people could throw. That's 81.6, I think, there from
brilliant throw.
Murafushi.
It's all in the timing, isn't it?
It's all in the hips,
it's all in the swivel. And you don't have to be a fat idiot.
No, you certainly don't. A thick on here from...
Bob, you know. Is he going to get it out of the net, or are you just going to leave it?
He's pulling the net down. Oh, look out, he's going to get right in on the thumb. It's alive, that one. I'll kill him with a stick, quick. He drags it out ruefully. Back in the ring, we've got Adrian Amos.
We've seen it before. We liked his style. He's the bigger sort of...
Older-fashioned, older style, who believes that weight is everything, and madness. Complete stupidity is the thing you need. Talking to yourself, I mean, how much more looming can you get?
Well, it was thought you had to be mad to do this, and this is a contrast in styles here. We've got the Japanese cool and calm, we've got the Hungarian mad. Let's see who comes out on top.
The Coachwood Myrtle in motion now. Here he goes. He finds the gap, and away it goes.
Well, he likes it. He's shouting it through, shouting it on.
83.19. The Tunstall stick the digging implement in. They've uncovered something there. Rueful look from the coach. That's a beautiful throw, Roy.
Dude, look how mad he is. Look how mad he is. Look how big he is and mad he is.
Beautiful. Is it any wonder women love this sport, boy?
They do.
I mean, there's more women around us here tonight than at any other event here. I mean, surely they might be in for the 100 metres later on, but now we have...
They've come to see the hammer.
They have. Ezrak Atpak from Turkey, one of the new generation who don't really care if they find the gap or not.
He's agreed.
Tremendous
style. Small man, smaller, isn't he?
Here he comes. He's away. He's in motion. Oh, straight to the net. But still worth a clap. And why not? Because he's come to compete.
I like the way they don't pick him up. He just wobbles off. Leave it to someone else. Someone has to clean up my muck.
79.51, his best throw so far. Now, Vadim Devyatovsky. A personality thrower. Moody.
He's not the dribbling idiot.
The dribbling idiot in motion from Belarus, straight into the net, and it falls down, and let's have a look. Oh, he's still got the touch. Yeah. Come on, put it away, pal. Atpak's back again. He's up for his fourth throw. Obviously, two legal throws. He looks at the...
That's exciting, right?
...view ahead. He thinks, well, girls have come to see me. I might as well do something here. And look, this is a sport I could get involved with, Roy. You know, I always thought that you had to be bloody fat to do this, but you
fat
don't.
Fat mad, you
fat mad. Well, I go with the madness bit.
That's a good throw.
Atpak's back. He's 79.23. He's right in contention here.
Dunstall comes over with a shovel to see if anything's unearthed.
Do you think he found something there?
You might have a couple of coins. Yeah, coins, anything. And here he comes. Paz
is from the Hungary again. Don't they have a mortgage on this event? Obviously, the junior to their anus tilt. Yeah. Great, no nonsense. Steps up to the plate. He's going to step up. If he can find that gap, he's right in this competition. Here it goes straight into the net. Mate. He almost knocked the fence over.
Wow, well, he went high in the net. Look at that. A monument to his stupidity.
You know, I mean, obviously, as we watch him replay...
God, great height. Who knows where that would have gone? Straight out of the stadium.
Look, he got enormous height because it's only about four feet away.
I know.
It's deceptive.
I wonder what the public liability is if it went to the stadium and killed a few people.
Murafushi back, the Japanese. Look at this. I mean, this is a revelation seeing Murafushi.
Ordinary-looking blokes.
Ordinary, straight off the street. Looks as though he could drive a car with ease. Most models he'd be able to slip in behind. No particular skills. He doesn't appear
mad. The way he presents. This presenting is a nice addition, isn't it?
And then he stoops down.
Entertainment cannon.
Indeed, stoops down to pick up the hammer. Doesn't waste any energy. Gets the rock in motion and has the twirl about the head. Then sights it down the end of the passage. Away it goes.
Whoa,
there, and he's got a
beautiful beauty.
He's unleashed a packet there, right? Look at the Tunstall's run.
What it's dug up. A couple of pots by the looks.
Yeah, a couple of cyclonic pots. And I think that's a great throw. But Anus is celebrating gold. And Murafushi is denied yet again in the competition in the hammer. Isn't that great? Hungary's success here in the throwing of the cisterns at the Mainawaka Stadium. And what a night for hammer freaks. Anus first, Murafushi second, and Tikon.
One of the real glamour events here at the track. And, Roy, it was a great night last night at the Awaka Maiden Stadium, wasn't it?
Well, it's good to see that madness is still an advantage.
It is.
In that sport.
It is. It's
because you're not going to find many sane people taking it up, let's face it.
No, except in the...
But I love it.
No, true. Wherever there was a little bit of madness, of course, Maurice Greene always brings a bit to the 100 metres.
Oh, he does. I always thought that.
Sort of work.
I always thought the hammer was probably his go.
That's right. There'll be more Dream in Athens right after this break. Congratulations on your efforts here in Athens. And to start with, Roy and I are calling for a probe into the men's swimming team. We believe we have to look at it from top to bottom, from start to finish, and the bits in the middle, and everything about it. Men's swimming, apart from Thorpe and Hackett, has let us down completely here. No surprises there, I might add. No surprises there. Do you support the probe that Roy and I are calling for?
I don't really care about the boys. I'm just worried about the girls, and I'm worried about me, basically.
Well, very sensible indeed. And Don Talbot's comments that the men are swimming just for themselves and not as a team. Have you made observations, similar observations to the Senior 7 commentator, is that?
The boys are all about team, and they always taking care of the, like, of the girls, of them, and they don't really care about Don's comments, so...
Oh, well, that's tremendous news, isn't it? Refreshing. Because all we hear...
I didn't believe a word of that.
No, well, quite. All we hear about is under the weight of Don.
Yeah.
Peering down on us.
Exactly,
Roy.
Exactly right. Look, Brooke, I noticed you're wearing your gold medal as well, which is great. Which is great. Has anyone asked you, I tell you what really gets up my nose, as a past winner, have you been asked to have a photograph biting your medal?
Biting it? Not yet.
Oh, what a relief. Because everyone I've seen has been, you've seen these stupid bloody photographs of people with a bloody medal in their mouth.
Oh, my parents would kill me. I had braces for like 6 years.
Yes. Yes. Now, there's been a lot said, a lot written in the paper, certainly back home, about the supposed imbroglio between yourself and Liesl. Now, has there been the opportunity to smoke the peace pipe?
Oh, definitely. We actually went out and had a dance and a drink together last night.
Fantastic.
And that's what it's about.
So. That's what it's about. Dancing and getting out and about.
I mean, these are pretty good medals, but, like, now the Olympics is about backing up 10 nights in a row, 2 hours sleep, drinking, dancing and just partying with everyone.
Have you... Has it been...
When you do all that, you need another gold medal.
Oh, sure. But, you know, to support Don, we would say this is the most successful swimming team, away swimming team in history. Has it been going off?
Yeah.
The parties, have they been going off?
It's been amazing. Like, we've just really, I guess, come together as a team and just had the best championships ever. And then we're like, right. It's done. Let's go out and party every night and, you know, see how hard we can go.
Would it have been a good idea to have the parties before the meet?
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
Well, I nearly lost my voice and we're only on night two, on night three tonight. So, no, not before the meet.
Now, what's your position with regard to the next 4 years? Are you thinking Beijing?
I think so, yeah, yes. Most definitely.
Can you calculate how many laps you'll have to swim between now and Beijing?
I would hate to think.
Right.
Probably from Melbourne to Beijing and back at least 100 times.
Well, that's not a bad start.
Yeah.
You know, Roy and I have always called for a nude swim around the world to raise money for the Olympics. You know, obviously, we get pretty heavy sponsorship. The idea would be dive in Bondi Beach, say, July 1st, say about 2 years from the Olympics, and, of course, welcome them back at Bondi Beach 2 years later. Would you think that was a good idea for just putting the Olympics really on the map?
Like, I'd be up for it for sure. I've already done black and white, so, you know, my body's out there. Everyone knows what it's like. Nude swimming, nude BLA.
Now, look, can I... having raised that, I'm glad... I wasn't going to raise that, but now that you've raised it... One of your co-strippers in black and white declares that she's performing better since she appeared in the publication. Have you put in PBs since you've appeared in the publication?
Don't go there.
No, it's not a hard question. Yes, no.
In the pool or in the bedroom?
Oh, well, either way. Well, again, I mean, look, I wasn't going to go there. I was thinking the pool.
Okay,
pool.
Of course. Well, I swam 2/100ths faster here than what I have earlier in the year, so if black and white helped me do that, so be it.
There you go. I think that's very true. I think, but look, it's a monkey off your back to get the gear off in public.
You'd
agree. I think that's absolutely right. I mean, when we were training years ago in Lithgow, the first thing we would do at the start of the season was walk through the streets nude, just to get that off our chests. And I'm glad that's happening with the Australian swimming team. When will you start training again, Brooke? When do you find yourself back in the pool? When does it start to get serious?
Well, I was meant to train...
It's all well and good to party for 2 days, but when does the training start again?
It was meant to start this morning, and some of my teammates left me in bed because they couldn't wake me up.
Yes.
So I was meant to start at 7 o'clock this morning, but I got home at 6, and, you know, I missed that session. But it was meant to start this morning, but maybe tomorrow morning.
Right. And where are the parties at? Are they in the Plaka? Are they in town?
They're sort of here, they're everywhere. Last night we were down on the beach, so
yes.
That was pretty nice. A bit of nude swimming, but not from me.
No.
Just speaking of going back to the nude swimming, and I wasn't going to raise this either, but am I right? in thinking that one of your media helpers is going to swim nude up and down in the pool because you've won medals? Is that right?
Oh, I don't know about that. That's, well, that's all right. That's the first I've heard about it.
Right, OK. Well, we hope that's on. Now, with a bit of cross-training, you're a very good body surfer. And what's your favourite beach and what sort of tricks can you do body surfing?
My favourite beach is definitely Currumbin Beach on the Gold Coast.
Yes.
And I'm a member of the surf club there, but my parents and my family are involved in the surf club and love the surf. And just, I guess, it's a lot easier than just racing up and down that pool like I had the last week. You can just hop on a wave, takes you all the way to the beach, and Mother Nature's taking care of you.
Now, you're in Melbourne now, which makes body surfing a lot harder.
It's too cold in Melbourne.
Too cold? Oh, right, OK. Roy.
Look, we have asked others on the program what sort of sponsorship they'd be looking for. Have any sponsors started getting in touch with you? Because the sponsors are going to come, Brooke, they're going to come.
I hope so. I'm keeping my fingers crossed. Well, as you probably know, I'm still driving my 1973 Toyota Celica, so, like, a car would be fantastic.
You're the second person two in a row wanting cars.
Yeah, look,
what sort of car would you like?
Anything that's better than a 73 Celica. I bought it for $700 in the trading post, and it breaks down every now and then, so...
Would an Audi All-Road be the sort of car you were looking at?
Mate, just a little Festiva or something would be
Festiva. Fine.
Toyota Corolla.
I'm sure that can be higher.
Much. Maybe just a little Toyota Corolla or something pretty cool just to get me around Melbourne a bit faster.
Well, look, Brooke, all the rest for the games, and everybody who comes on the show gets this, well, I was going to say exclusive pin. It's becoming less exclusive as the fortnight goes on, but it's a 24-carat shovel. A small shovel that suggests Roy and I's desire to finish the games off for the people of Athens, and also the idea that everybody loves to dig here. So we'd like you to accept
this. Thanks so much, guys. That's awesome.
As part of a souvenir of your time here.
Yes,
and Roy.
And always, you know. Let's raise it, Brooke. People are going white. Here's the golden shovel sorbent extra to take home with you to put in the boot of the Festiva, should one touch it.
And can you please thank Brooke Hanson?
And you know we don't give up. It's like your birthday. You find me in the club. Bottle full of blood. My mind got what you need.
Here in Athens, love to dig no matter where, even when they're on holidays, no matter where they are or what they're up to. They have the spades in the boot of the car, just on the off chance that the mood takes them.
You always know you're going to find something. I tell you what, a metal detector would be good here as well.
It would, it'd be tremendous.
Now, I've been trying to source one, I can't yet, but I'm hoping, you know, in my spare hours.
To get a bit up.
Get out there and just sort of find some old coins.
Mm-hmm. Roy, I don't want to put you on the spot, but would you like to smash a plate?
I'd love to smash a plate because it does lead us neatly into a searing issue.
Well, maybe we should save the plates until we get a chance to develop the outrage.
The thesis.
Look, boxing has been part of the Olympic movement for many, many years.
Boxing. I didn't know you were going to go with boxing. Is that where we're going?
We're going with boxing, Roy.
Boxing.
Yeah, that's right, Roy. I wouldn't try any more with that bit. I'd get another bigger bit. Now, boxing. And, of course, the people who know their Olympic history know that boxing and controversy have danced Zorba style, a very attractive tune for many, many years. In fact, who can forget Seoul, where there was a sit-in in the ring? And... You're going to do them all at once?
No.
Oh, well, I'm trying not to.
It depends where it goes. I don't know where you're going yet.
I'd like to draw our attention to a bout last night between Adam Forsyth, an Australian, in the 91-kilogram class. We've got some vision here of Adam going around, and certainly... Well, this is a bit tricky here, but, yeah, as you can see, the Egyptian boxer is leading Adam quite convincingly here. But if you look, Adam tends to land punches without getting any score. Now, what I've got to point out here is that Adam is in the blue and his opponent, Muhammad El Sayed, is in the red.
Yes.
Now, as we flip through the bout, there's a couple of punches there. No score to Adam.
Yes.
Plenty of score to Muhammad.
Yes.
So it gets up 26-11.
Yes.
And as we can see, the referee gradually grinds the fight to a halt.
Right, you've been very kind calling him a referee, HG.
Indeed. Now, unfortunately, that was set up a bit quickly.
Yes.
So what we might have to do is ask to see if we can go back to those images,
yes,
because what I was developing a point was Adam, 91 kilogram class, Muhammad, 91 kilogram class, quarterfinals, meaning that only 16 boxers entered this. So what happens if Adam could get through this bout? He would have a chance of getting to the medal. Here we go again.
Yes,
Adam in blue. As we see the score in the bottom left-hand corner, the punches have to be landed, don't they, Roy?
They do have to be landed. And what you'll note is that every time Adam in blue puts one on the Egyptian...
As we see there,
as we see there,
no change in the score.
The Egyptian gets the points.
Yes, indeed. No change to the score then.
No change to the score. So, and obviously, when the Egyptian does, get a glove within, 2 kilometres of
the blue bloke,
he gets 4 or 5 points. So that the blue kitty, the Australian kitty, is being punished every time he hits.
He's
the Egyptian. He's denied points. Now, this, I just don't get it. I thought the idea was, I hit you,
what?
Bing, I get a point.
Yeah.
Not, I hit you, bing,
bing,
bing, he gets a point.
Now,
I don't understand.
We were
and
there.
So we've been inundated with emails and faxes and letters saying, can we start a
probe
into what is going on with Olympic boxing? It stinks to high heaven. It's been stinking to high heaven ever since I can remember. And if ever there was a sport crying out to be smacked off to be busted like a plate, it is Olympic boxing. It is just a farce. It's a fiasco, a modern fiasco.
You know, Roy and I, you and I were at the bout last night. Sure, we didn't have the best seats in the house.
No.
We were about half a kilometre from us, sitting by ourselves completely there. And I've got to say, is that you were outraged. And when you dropped the trousers and turned your back on the bout, bent over and gave him a brown eye, you were not alone. That was the weird thing about it. There were hundreds of people doing exactly the same thing. And when we got back that night to the village where we were staying, we bumped into Jimmy Neely and Richie Woodall, the senior seven boxing commentators.
The most respected boxing commentators in the world.
And let's have a listen to their wrap-up of the bout last night. Here it is here.
And Egypt have got, for the very first time, a medal in the Olympic boxing tournament. And this fella is grinning as much now as he did when he came into the ring, as if he knew that the bronze medal was his.
With appalling refereeing, and the judges were very complimentary to the Egyptian. Awful.
You're being very kind about the judges. Well, that's the second night in a row that we've ended the tournament with booing, because the knowledgeable crowd know exactly what is going on. This was a disgraceful piece of officiating yet again, involving an Egyptian boxer. Thank you very much, judges.
Yes, so it wasn't just us who were up in arms about it. Normally, very measured, very diplomatic, very proper commentators, and it takes a lot to get Jim and Richie outraged, but they were obviously livid, Roy.
And who's,
livid.
Who's our go-to man here?
It's certainly not Dick Pound, is it, Roy?
Dick wouldn't put up with this.
No.
Dick wouldn't put up with this.
No.
And now I've put this repeatedly to Jacques. I had a word with Jacques just the other day.
Yes.
I've put it to him repeatedly. What is he going to do about boxing?
It's corrupt.
He just shrugs.
And I'll tell you what,
shrugs and walks away.
That referee also is meant to...
What sort of answer is that?
I don't know. Yeah. What does he do again, Roy?
Is that Belgian for I'm getting stuck into it?
Roy,
so...
Yes?
This, remember, I chipped off the Temple of Zeus. You were there.
I held you.
I'm prepared to destroy this, to destroy this here on national television with plates, to try and ram the point home to Rog to do something about this so that it never happens again.
Okay. Now then, wow, how can I go on? There'll be more Dream in Athens after the break. Here. Yeah. don't get a chance to dwell on the team sports on this show as much as we'd like. And a bit of an update, obviously, men's basketball, wobbly tilt. Women's basketball, thumbs up. Men football, a lot of fouls. They didn't like the Australian style here much in Athens. No surprises there. Have a look at the boxing and draw your own conclusions. Women's football, no. Hockey, men, they're going okay. Women, right out of it, no good. Let's see, as I turn the page here, what else have we got? We've got softball. Good news. We're into the gold medal bout in the softball. We're playing the United States. I think we can go some pictures here. Apparently, the game is underway at the moment. Tony Squires will have the rest of the match for you right after we finish in a few minutes' time. Yeah. Apparently, USA have ripped into it, and they're 4-0 at the bottom of the what, Roy?
The bottom of the third is my understanding, HG. I thought we were going to get some... No, the pictures have gone. The camera's broken down. Okay.
That can happen.
That happens. Well, that happens. Well, if that's the case, we could...
Could you describe the first three innings for us, Roy? What you've seen so far? Or would you like to smash
it? No. I could pull people's twang here. And I can say that at the moment, with the women's softball team, we're up 8-0.
That's right. That's right. Roy, we might be able to go.
Oh, no, we have pictures now. Do we?
Let's have a look. Pictures?
Yeah! Okay,
3-0 as described.
Yeah.
Obviously, Australia in the field, Roy.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it's a bit hard to quickly to assess the pitching style of the Australians, but we've been going fairly well, really, haven't we? Because the Americans can pole on the rooms, can't they?
Yes, they can. It looks... Yeah.
Well held at the moment.
I'd say we're in good shape here, HG. We're only three back, although my information was that these might be recorded pictures and we're actually 4 down, but that was a beautiful bit of picture, a beautiful bit of teamwork there.
It's a terrific sport for television.
It's a great sport for television. Yeah. Made for television.
Made for television. And, you know, just on the what you've seen so far, Roy, a prediction on the score at the end, Australia victory?
Australia certainly meddling.
Meddling. Of course, they'll either get gold or silver.
Yeah.
Gold or silver. This is the gold medal playoff.
Yeah.
And I must say, one of the great things about the Athens Olympics is the disappointment of, the American team sports, especially the basketball, which has been rocked by a couple of losses here and there. This touted dream team.
That's right.
Millions upon millions and millions of dollars.
$600 million worth, beaten up by Lithuania.
Yeah.
That's right.
Who've got a team worth $4, as I understand.
$4.
Now, Roy, obviously superstition plays an enormous part in any Olympic tilt. And Irina Lashko, one of our divers, brought along a coin, I think, that was given to her by her daughter and had obviously suggested, or the daughter suggested, that she throw it in the pool and have a go at diving for it, before the competition started. And that turned out to be good. I think Irina placed third in the team's event. Now, Roy, superstitions here.
Yes. I think we did have some footage of Irina's coin at one stage.
Let's have a look if we can find it. And now this is great footage because it clearly shows where the coin
is. Is that the coin?
Where's
the coin? Oh, it's there somewhere. There it is.
It's right on the line.
Yes, that looks like a 1994. dollar coin.
Let's have a look. Irina Lashko there.
Yeah.
Oh, she's going to swim down and get it? No.
I think she leaves it
too far.
She leaves it there.
And terrific. It turned out to be trumps for the team there in the synchro diving. Roy, what other superstitions have you heard of at the games?
Look, I think all sports people, generally speaking, have superstitions. I don't like it.
No.
It can lead to difficulty. I remember years ago, actually, in the Lithgow diving competition, which was pretty keenly fought from memory.
Who was your main opponent? Stomper Steins?
Stomper wasn't diving that year. He was diving very well the year before, but lost form. Terry Brennan was my main
rival
that year, and he drove his father's Valiant Charger
into the pool.
Into the pool, as his wont, because he found he was diving very well with it in the pool. Nobody objected, apart from his father, but by the head or there, the car was bugged anyway. Let's face it, he won the competition. But see, that's where what if he'd gone on to, Olympic heights and turned up say, at Antwerp.
Yeah, or Montreal.
Or Montreal, with the charger, say, you mind if I put it in the pool, because brings out the best in me. Because they'd accepted, you know, oh, well, we had someone here putting a dollar coin in there, and that was OK. Where does it end? If you're going to have a dollar coin in there, you might as well have a bloody valiant charger. You see what I mean? Well, you've got to have standards. You've got to have rules.
Yeah, rules.
You've got to have boundaries. You've got to say, nothing in the pool.
Yeah.
Nothing in the pool.
Right, no,
if you want... Ms. Lasco, if you want to have your dollar coin here, either put it beside the pool, in your trousers, or keep it in your locker room, or let someone, have it for you at home. Don't put it in the pool.
Fair enough.
Because it's just going to start everyone coming in, dumping their rubbish in the pool, saying it's superstition.
Yeah.
You see what I mean? You see where it can end up? With people just diving on rubbish.
Have you talked to Rog about it, Roy?
The go-to man.
The go-to.
No, I'm still struggling with the boxing with Rog. Get the boxing up, then we'll go to the Irene Alaska bloody dollar coin in the pool. Fiat, go.
Now, the trouble is, if you rely on superstitions, of course, when you lose the superstition, I mean, we do have a lucky Phobos here. But the other day I did a bummer of a show because I'd lost the Phobos. I didn't know where to look. I found it in the boot of Roy's car eventually, where he'd put it because he was going off to the diving and was going to actually put it in the bottom of the pool. But do you see what I mean? I think the Canadian team, the baseball team, had one of those bobble-headed stupidities called Justin the Bobblehead. And they left it behind in Canada and they had to send up one of the, members of the, media liaison people back to Canada to get Justin the Bobblehead, because otherwise they wouldn't
have... It had to come in a diplomatic bag.
It did. They wouldn't be able to play baseball. I mean, talk about, messing with their heads.
Well, I think with team selections, the coaches have just got to say, listen, have you got any superstitions?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes, I do. You're out.
Yeah. Lucky underpants.
There's the door. Mark her off.
Yeah, that's true.
We don't want you here because you're stupid. You're a great diver, Ashley. You're a marvellous diver, but you're stupid.
You're right, Roy. I've been an idiot to you myself with my bobble-headed collection. I've got 400,000 of them. I might move on to snow domes now. I get snowies from all over the world. Is that all right, Roy? And that's the sort of way I'd approach that. Anyway, there'll be more of Dream in Athens right after this. Tonight we invented a new sport, the 100 metres limbo. Now, Roy, we did advertise that Gary Hall Jr., one of our dearest friends of the Olympic family, would be joining us this evening. Sadly, Gary has been stuck in traffic. However,
I heard it was gastric.
It's, well, between the two.
Gastric in traffic. What a malady.
Right. Look, unfortunately, Gary can't join us today, but if he was here, we would ask him whether he would support a probe into the Australian men's swimming team. And I think that he'd give that the thumbs up, knowing Gary and a lot of other swimmers.
His answer would be, yeah, I think so.
Now, Roy, obviously the emails, if you do want to get in touch with us, thedream.7.com.au and follow the prompts. Yeah. And some people have. Roy, have you got one there?
Look, I should have one here somewhere, actually. I did have it a moment ago. Have you got one there?
Look, here you go. I've got one here you might like to make a start with.
Thank you very much. Yes. Look, this comes from Steve. He says, why is it marathon runners only have to run one race? Why not make them run heats and semis? And have only the best in the final.
Yeah.
In fairness to all other sports.
Well, I think
he's absolutely right.
Have you approached Rob with that suggestion, Roy?
Well, there's a probe underway.
What else you got there?
Yes, I've got one here, actually. This is from Adam in Sydney. He says, why don't the horses in the equestrian events march in the opening ceremony? Here they are, giving their all, and they can't be part of the festivities. Or the closing ceremony. Also, do horses have to be from the country they're representing, or they can be? Can they be ringers?
Yes.
Well, I understand they can come from anywhere.
Yeah. The German team had a number of Irish horses which were born in Australia. Work that out. thedream.7.com.au if you want to send us an email. Roy, your medal tally tonight. This is an absolute ball terror. Not a word I often use on television, but it is.
Yes, goes as follows, HG. New Zealand, with 4 million people, has 2 gold, no silver, no bronze, for a total of 2. But if they had the population of Australia, they'd now have 10 gold for a total of 10. Australia, with 20 million people, has 12 gold, 8 silver and 13 bronze for a total of 33. But if we had, that is Australia, had the population of the United States of America, that is 280 million, we'd now have 168 gold, 112 silver, 182 bronze for a total of 462.
And looking ahead here on Channel 7, Tony's got the climax of the gold medal playoff, Australia v USA, and then we've got the cycling, the men's 4,000 team pursuit, the one that Roy brought the three home on the bike, on the one bike there in Moscow all those years ago. It's a marvellous event. And tomorrow night there'll be even more dream in Athens from the Games of the 28th Olympiad. We'll see you then. Bye now.